So, I am curious. This Ruby Chess GUI. Well, first of all, is this the appropriate library that I want to be using? This is something that's easily drivable from, I don't know, an IRB shell, for example. I'm really pretty far out of my comfort zone doing Windows development in Ruby, trying to do some kind of web development stuff. Hey, Penguin GMBot. This is about as far as you could possibly get out of my comfort zone with development without resorting to doing things that don't make any sense. I mean, maybe I lied, maybe involving Active Directory services or something. There's some other kind of really advanced technology could complicate this further, but all the simple pieces are in place. We've got the Ruby GUI over here. We've gotten, where was it? Oops, I want to change directory back up a level. And Ruby main.rb. There's my socket connection to LeeChess. So, if I so desired, I could, in that socket code, I had that open here just a second ago. Here it is. Still haven't found a really effective way to do this. Oh, I forgot I had something on my Linux box. Can I still get to that from here? Yeah, let's pop the box open. Okay, switch user over here. Clear. Move this into my other browser just so I don't have a billion windows open, just a million. Clear. I had, what was it? Okay, so that's the contents of the TV. Oh, here it was, test.sh. So you could do like this and obtain a list of bullet games, apparently. I don't have any idea how this works. That's pretty cool. Was able to. Your proof of concept. No, I'm not developing in C sharp. Thanks for offering. I mean, I do still have it as a reference example here, but I don't develop with that kind of proprietary library. I could seek to do this sort of similar thing, in a more open language. I could certainly follow this skeleton, but I mean. Well, okay, so this shows me an example of get a top game for a category where we add to the header. In fact, is this similar in any way to, yeah, the one-liner? Except what yours does is it deserializes the JSON into an easier to parse structure, at least within C sharp. So I want to see if I can accomplish the same thing in Ruby. It's good to know that these are all the category names, and I can reference that for sure. Oops, okay, what's Nightbot up to this time? That's impressive. That said, I mean, I'm still confused what your goal is with this. I mean, it's fantastic and excellent that you're doing this all in C sharp, or you're not doing this for my sake, right? Because that would make me feel bad. It's good to see the skeleton and the pseudocode and all that. However, I'm not seeking to do this in C#, so I'd have to copy this code and perform it in a different language. Either that, or I could learn there is a C# equivalent for Linux. I'm drawing a blank at the moment as to what it is. Yeah, that's pretty cool. So let me get that. Hastebin.com. Okay. And then, yeah, we can view that together. Again, I'm not aiming at all to do this in... Oh, that's not working. That's not at all what I was looking for. Shoot. Okay, let's... Instead of wget, let's use a browser to get to it, or... Let's just open this in my browser. Even though now I'm in Windows, and so I have to find a way to get the raw version of this on... Okay, here we are. Wget that thing. Move that thing to that thing.c#. View that thing.c#. Yeah, this is your implementation for doing it in C#, which is cool. Congrats. That's quite an achievement. I don't have any way of running this code on my Linux development machine. And while I could do this on Windows, even if I could code it on Windows, I would have challenges deploying it because I just struggle compiling and deploying things for Windows. I could purchase commercial software, I suppose, that would allow me to more easily deploy C# applications, but they would still be bound to a Windows platform, and the majority of developers I deal with don't do things exclusively on Windows. But no, this is pretty cool. It shows you, like, all the pseudocode for all the events and things. Oh, the ping just to keep things open. So you got a ping timer that pings every 2.5 seconds or something like that. And each tick, it calls ping. And you call ping, it checks like if we have a last move and if there is a last move. Type ping value last move. Okay, so that's the LeetJS protocol. It's, you send a JSON back that has type of P and value of the last move. And that's currently the protocol. I don't really know. Like, Java so heavily drew away from C# developers that only those religious zealots for the Microsoft platform stuck with the language. But I think that D and J and Ruby and Haskell and Lua and Elixir and all that have... gained a lot of interest, and people really haven't been as interested in C# lately. I was thinking of F#. That's what I was thinking of. But I don't know anything about F# other than once years ago I read a little bit about it. Yeah, so in theory you could use a single socket for all games. To start observing another game called Start Watching. Okay. That's cool. Like, I don't understand what public dynamic last move is, as opposed to like public static or public string or public move. I guess dynamic means that the move to the object type is dynamic because it's determined by JSON. Yeah, C sharp's a good language, it's just not very popular. Okay. To start watching a game, I'd call start watching. I'm more curious at the moment, can I drive the Ruby Chess GUI using Ruby code? Windows Ruby GUI. Or is there a better selection? Oops, Ruby Chess GUI. It's the chess engine. I remember reading about this, but there's no GUI aspect to this. Yeah. Okay. Shoes. Oh, that's cute. That is so cute. Just that they put the block letters there, just like to tell you that, oh, anybody can learn to do this. It's the kind of impression that they're trying to give. And it's never that simple. Ruby promises to make everything simple. I mean, I don't buy it one bit. Although that said, the Ruby GUI library that we were looking at a second ago, let's see, there was Ruby Chess GUI.rb. This is all based in shoes, so, oh. But apparently, I have to change directory to Ruby Chess to do that for the images to load properly. So, yeah. I'm really not aiming to do. You're right that. Doing things in JavaScript's probably the easiest way to go. JavaScript is not. I'm not aiming to make a web app. Even though, really, the sensible thing here would be to do a web app, but Lichess has already done that. That's not what I'm aiming for. I know that works great for Lichess 4545. But I don't know, the minute you start doing web development, you're contained in the browser, and the browser dictates what you can and can't do, and it offers you a lot of flexibility. But if you want your code to work across multiple browsers, so it works on everybody's PCs, then you've got to have your Safari, you have to have your Edge, you have to have your Firefox, your Chrome, your Opera, all these things you have to be testing constantly. And while it's great. You can make your code work for everybody, and it's doable. It's just, that's not my objective at the moment. I want to make something that just works on my computer. And if other people want to make it work on their computer, they could edit the code and find a way to edit it to make it work, and that I'm okay with that. But yeah, I want to, be able to view Lichess games in my own Ruby code. And I mean, yeah, developing a web app would make sense, except Lichess is already a web app, so we're doing something different. That and Zug keeps saying how incredibly simple it is to do all this stuff, and I'm just seeing. Can I learn something from all of this as opposed to just arguing with him? And yeah, doing a web app would be a good way to do it, but that's not what I'm doing. So what's this? Tarash Chess GUI. Is this in TCL, or what's this in? I can't guess what library this is for or from. I'm guessing this is not open source either. Not that I'm even interested if it's, well, I mean, if it's some other language, like assembly or JavaScript or some other silly thing, I probably wouldn't want it anyway. But yeah, I'm pretty sure this isn't open source. Why did somebody make this thing? What's the point? Oh. Tarash is developed in the open on GitHub. I've never seen GitHub spelled that incorrect. Oh, that's just a B in there. Let's just say GitHub instead of GitHub. There's an extra B there. Okay. So, why was this done? Okay, it's still under development. 24 days ago. Okay, cool. It's a simple desktop workbench. What language is this in? Usually GitHub shows some kind of language indicator somewhere. Oh, C++. Now this dude assures you that it can run on Windows. Okay, good for him. Not what I'm doing, but not sure why this came up when I searched for a Ruby Windows chess GUI. Because this definitely isn't Ruby. But what was his objective? I know I've gone off on a tangent here. maybe. Yeah. I can't just add anybody who wants it, but I know you're contributing a lot of helpful links. It's just they're all distracting me from what I'm trying to do, but okay, Electron is, I mean, also I could look up some of these things, like you could just say the Electron library, but plus when I click on these things, they don't even show up in my browser on stream anyway, because my chat window is disconnected from my stream. Build desktop apps is your point. It's easy. Everything's easy. just use Node.js and Chrome. Okay. Chromium's not shit. Chromium's okay. Makes sense. This is the good way to do a browser. Yes, this, if you're aiming to make something that works on everybody's computer, this is a good way about doing it. That's unfortunately not my goal, but this is definitely a useful example. It's just not at all what I'm intending to do. This is all very good though. Part of the reason I'm not aiming to do it this way is because I'm aiming to learn Ruby better, and then from having learned Ruby, prepare to learn Elixir and Phoenix framework. Phoenix being the web server application that's based on Elixir, Elixir being the functional programming language, which is to succeed Ruby. So, yeah, now this is definitely the best option for making your own browser, like I'm doing. What I'm doing incorrectly, and this is the right way to do it. But my goal isn't so much the end product as it is to just get reacquainted with Ruby. Get more familiar with that sort of syntax, which has some things in common, but not everything in common, with the Elixir syntax. It's not a browser. No, I mean, it's based on the Chromium browser, really. Chromium is a browser. I think you knew that, but it's using that to render HTML and run JavaScript using Node for the app logic. I mean, we're talking semantics here. Yeah, the app could be done in a way that abstracts away the GUI. I guess you could write an app and then not use Chromium. This uses Node.js with JavaScript, and then uses your good old HTML CSS. Although, like you're saying, you don't necessarily need to use the Chromium front end. It's just offered there for you to simplify your task of rendering things. But yeah, you would use JavaScript for the app logic. I really don't hold JavaScript in high regard, although it is a high performance language. I mean, if I wanted to do this in JavaScript, I would do exactly what the LeechS team did. This works beautifully. It is, they used Scala cross-compiled to JavaScript via closure, and it's perfect that they've got all their unit test coverage by virtue of having the unit tests built into Scala and into the simple build tool, and then they're able to easily deploy it to all browsers by cross-compiling through closure to JavaScript. No, I get it that Node's an application framework. And if you want to work with the Node framework, you're not going to write it in like assembly. You're not going to write it in Lua. You're going to write your code in JavaScript. Now, you could call other applications or call DLLs or whatever you want to call through JavaScript. That's doable. It's all server-side code anyhow. But no, I'm aiming to do things in an object-oriented language. Plus, in a way, Chromium, I mean, it's unfair to disparage Chromium for the sins that Chrome commits, because Chromium, it's all open source. Anybody can contribute to it. There's no, nothing nefarious there. Yeah, it is possible to do object orientation in JavaScript. Really, you can do anything in JavaScript. There's no reason not to use it for every possible problem. You're right. ES6, EMCA script 6, does help quite a bit with spanning the gap there. Well, just aside from classes, there's just a crapload of awful JavaScript code out there. So in terms of finding good reference examples, you're kind of on your own. Now I get that Ruby and Rails for a time were kind of in that category, and then a number of mature libraries evolved, and that's not the scene anymore. that there are tons of good Ruby code examples. And I get that Elixir is kind of in this category where it's such a new language that finding good example code to follow can be kind of challenging. But to offset that, Elixir is just a very strong language. Yeah, JavaScript provides tons of freedom, and unfortunately that's just a little too much. It's too open-minded. That's unfortunate, and I'm curious whether WebAssembly will solve some of those issues. I don't really know much about WebAssembly. I'm not a web developer. Yeah, you can avoid bad patterns if you happen to know what you're doing. And yeah, it is quite good that EMCA Script 6 is offering classes. So you're not completely hanging there. You can do things in an object-oriented fashion. And browsers which support JavaScript and correctly support it and don't have bugs, your code will work just fine. Or like you're saying, you don't even have to do it in browsers. You could write server-side code using JavaScript. There's a lot of really powerful things you can do with the language. Even so, I just struggle finding good examples of how to do things with that particular language. I mean, just tell me the name of the book. I can look it up. You don't need to drop a link here every time. I mean, yeah, you really have to know what you're doing. Now, that said, well, okay, let me offer things in a less negative or more positive light. Elixir language. It's a functional, concurrent, and general-purpose programming language. It runs on the Erlang VM, builds on top of Erlang, and shares the same abstractions for building distributed, fault-tolerant applications. It's a really useful, powerful language that is eventually going to be used for web servers. JavaScript, the good parts. Yeah. So this is a really new language. I know many months ago I did attempt to do a stream about me trying to learn Elixir and Phoenix Framework, and I just struggled reading the documentation. In my defense, it was like 6 a.m. or something, and I hadn't slept very well the night before. The advantage over this is type safety, that it can be optimized to bytecode, that it can be deployed and redeployed on a live machine, it has, I think there are good ways to easily, conveniently write unit tests for the language. It follows a functional programming paradigm, so you're not doing imperative programming. Yeah. Well, the people at one point said that Ruby was unpopular. And eventually it gained in popularity and it took over the scene. And I think this is going to follow, and this is going to take over Ruby and Rails. This Elixir and Phoenix framework is going to be the future of web servers. I don't think there's even going to be a contest there. Yeah, I honestly don't know. Like, I'm not doing anything to filter him out. I didn't know. I mean, Nightbot sure timed you out, but your timeout's run out, and I don't understand why Night's chat server doesn't show you there. There's, as far as I can know, there's not a way to force a person to show up in that particular chat server. I can't figure out, like, there's no blacklist or anything. I don't know why he's not showing up. Anyway, so this compiles to bytecode for Erlang VM. Everything's an expression, so you can write some really complicated expressions, and the compiler will know which sections of the expression need to be expressed or evaluated in order for other code to properly execute. So there's a lot of advantages to using a functional programming language, and using a VM, which allows you to efficiently redeploy the code while the code is running. Admittedly, some of those things can be done with JavaScript as well, but in terms of optimization and code coverage, as well as ease of understanding, just being able to read somebody else's code and quickly diagnose like where things are going right or wrong, it's just spectacular. I'm only saying that from the perspective that I've done some code in Scala, and while the code is hard as hell to write, once it's written, it's pretty easy to diagnose what's going on. Yeah. Plus, the idea of this providing fault-tolerant code allows you to proofread libraries that people write and understand what you're deploying. Where was this? There was a funny story about NPM dependency. What was this? Problem. There was once a panic in the NPM ecosystem where people had, package manager dependency. There was quite the scare when somebody, I think it was LeftPad, one of the authors of LeftPad got pissed off. Yeah, here we are. How one programmer broke the internet by deleting a tiny piece of code. So, developer briefly broke the internet. He was really just trying to get people to give credit for what he did for a particular one of his libraries. He couldn't get the name that he wanted to, so he removed his software from the package provider, and it turns out that like half the internet had copied his code or made dependencies upon it for something simple that just pads a string with spaces. And this is the error that everybody was getting, and all the web servers were down. And this is all in JavaScript, by the way. Not saying the JavaScript is at fault, but people, they build this addiction to that sort of thing. And good luck convincing an employer that, oh no, we shouldn't be using that code because they don't do things correctly. The employer will just look at that and see, oh, it's JavaScript. It's in a library, it seems to function right. What need do we have for doing things correctly? you're not gonna be able to convince people this is about the differences between good code and bad code. A manager just cares, does the code function today? And will it probably function tomorrow? They don't really have the long-term vision that, you know, maybe we shouldn't be using the NPM packages. Maybe we should have code reviews of people's code, so they shouldn't be using these things, which, if removed, could break our entire server. But whatever. It's hard to write good JavaScript, that's for sure. And that's why people tend to depend on these sort of dependencies. And then when everything goes to shit, it's suddenly thrust in your lap to go fix it. and it's reliable until something in the ecosystem goes wrong and nobody has any idea what's going on. And that's not going to happen, I don't think, with Elixir. Yeah, that was great. That was fantastic. Double angle brackets in C++ broke the compiler. Yeah, now everything breaks at some point, but when something breaks and you can't even figure out where the break happened, or even if you can figure it out, that there's no way to figure out a solution for it, just because you've depended upon something that you don't understand. Like, my philosophy here would be, don't use NPM for production code. That's very extreme, but my justification for that would be, nobody fully understands NPM, and this kind of shit can happen, and, you know, that's kind of important. I mean, I've had production code, or I've been asked to write something, been advised that there's only one way to write it and that I should write it this way, and despite my advice, they make me write it because that's what they need. And I give them all kinds of warnings and disclaimers saying, by the way, this could break at any time for any reason. And they say, yeah, go ahead and write it anyway because it works today. And that bugs me a lot. I don't believe in writing code that's going to break in production, but whatever. Yeah, as long as you have backups, you're fine. But, I mean, I've even worked with clients who don't do backups. Not that it's even the client's responsibility. This should be server-side code anyway, but yeah, you're not going to have any luck convincing a manager about the importance of backups either. Yeah, it's a mess. There's never enough time and attention given to all the important details that are necessary for doing things correctly. Others, popular opinion, lamented the fact that an 11-line package existed at all, suggesting that programmers should reinvent the wheel every time. That's funny. Yeah. Something's got to pay the bills, though, you know? I mean, yeah, it can be terribly unsatisfying. Anyhow, that was quite the crisis. I forget when this happened. When did this occur? Is there a date on this story? It was quite a spectacular panic. March 22nd. I'm going to assume that this was last year. That doesn't seem right, but... But yeah, everybody's blaming everybody according to this particular author. And while I don't think that that's fair, this is probably a less spectacular, I don't know. Ashley Williams kicked off her powerful paint-by-number keynote at Node.js Interactive by explaining that NPM is actually a for-profit company. It makes money by selling its enterprise services, and apart from the amounts to run the everyday operations, its revenue is invested in keeping the NPM registry. Okay. Williams also addressed the elephant in the room by tackling the topic of unpublishes when developers remove their code. A disgruntled developer unpublished all his modules. Well, I mean, that's true. But do we have to call them disgruntled? I mean, a developer could choose to unpublish all their modules for whatever reason. Among them was a seemingly harmless chunk of code, LeftPad. All the shit hit the fan. Williams admitted that a LeftPad debacle happened because of some naive policies. Well, sure, there's always growing room there. They devised new policies, the main one being that you're only allowed to unpublish within 24 hours of publishing. Now, I think that's a way to get people pissed at you, but whatever. Now Electron is perfectly suited for the project. I just really have a bias against JavaScript. Oh no. No. I mean, this violates the whole notion of copyright. And the code that you publish being yours. Now, if you publish something, it belongs to NPM. Or at least they have an eternal license to continue publishing it. So any developer that's worth their salt will realize that this probably isn't the marketplace that they want to use anymore. Because it doesn't offer them the flexibility to take things down, for example, if they're part to a lawsuit. So if a developer publishes something and gets sued over it, they can't even take it down. So, you could always try to email them. They'll try to be not naive and maybe help you out. But, that's a problem. That's quite extreme that you can't unpublish your resources. That's not the right way to handle it. I'm not saying that there's a better way, we've swung the pendulum from one side to the other. And unless you're offering the developer some kind of disclaimer that it's safe for them to publish here, they can get in a lot of trouble for it. I have no idea, and I'm not sure if it matters. He could have suspected that other people depended upon his code. I don't know. But I think it falls to other people to question why the fuck they were using NPM in the first place. They clearly didn't understand the importance of having backups. You could argue, as some have argued, that they're using a library which uses a library which uses a library which uses the LeftPad library, and they couldn't have possibly been expected to understand this chain of dependencies. But at the same time, like, if you're using NPM, you should have some kind of idea of how it works. NPM's convenient, but goodness, if you're writing important code, make sure you understand what you're doing. And NPM is a great way to write things quickly and get things done pretty quickly. But I don't know. It just seems very naive. I mean, yeah, you're absolutely right that Electron is suitable for what I'm doing. But that's not the way I'm choosing to tackle this, because I prefer to do things using other languages, other libraries. Not that I am particularly fond of Ruby, but I'm using that as a stepping stone to get back into Elixir and Phoenix. So I do have something in mind, and unfortunately it's just quite different than the MVC approach that's taken in Node. Don't blame the platform. Okay, fine. Yeah, no, let's blame the developers. Okay. Unfortunately, most people like to do things quickly and conveniently. Yeah, well, and it's hard to justify to, I don't know, to everybody, to the entire chain of command that, hey, we need to spend some time figuring things out. Whereas they're like, they really want to get things done as quickly and efficiently as possible, and to hell with any potential concerns that don't actualize in terms of something that breaks the software. So that said, what I will gain from this, and yeah, getting that, I could write this all in Electron, that's cool, but I want to grab this, copy that over here, start watching a game, want to copy this. Ping. Just send that over the socket. Ping type ping value move value last move. Something like that. Let me indent this a little further. There we go. Not yet implemented, of course. And then, like you're saying, there's all these sorts of things that can come back from the server. There's all the TV categories. It's all worth knowing. I'm not pursuing that at the moment, although it's, I've got that for later reference if I really need it. And then download string TV slash category. Oh, right. This is a string substitution or injection into that format. So I could get like TV slash blitz or TV slash whatever. And if I remember right, TV slash bullet goes there. So I guess that gets the last N bullet games. If I want to do blitz, let's do blitz. And then we can do that and see that, hey, we get some blitz games. It's a lot of blitz games. I'm surprised to get so many. As I was surprised earlier to get so many bullet games. I don't understand the point of getting this much data back. It's quite a lot. Oh wait, now this is not just getting the blitz games. This is getting the games, game metadata for all the games, as well as getting, I'm curious why it gets the FEN for each game, but it's probably a bit of a bother to filter that server side. Just answer a question of, can this perform? Can this platform or language support a professional development? And JS, Node, and NPM sure can. They just don't go out of the way. Yeah. Yeah, that's true. No, for sure you can do things with Node and NPM, and they don't prevent you from, they don't prevent hobbyists from doing things in JavaScript, or in Node for that matter. It's kind of the opposite of Java, where Java is very well structured and very much keeps hobbyists away. Although somehow he hasn't managed to keep Zugact away. He's managed to keep at it. That's impressive. But, yeah, Node and NPM are pretty much the opposite extreme, where it's wide open and welcoming. I mean, gosh, like, by that standard, C++ kind of is in that category too. It tried very hard to be all things to all people. And even today, like, they do enhance the C++ standard, but my God, if you're looking at some C++ code, you're probably in trouble. Just saying. I mean, yeah, it can be used for production code. It can be used for hobbyist code. It can be used for a whole variety of things. But if somebody asks you, "Are you C++ developer?" you say yes, and then be like, "Great, why don't you go help me with this thing?" And you could spend weeks on some kind of problem that they're stuck on. Writing language, but it does attempt to offer many features. Actually saw this funny video forever ago. I don't even remember what it was called, so this is gonna fail badly. Idiosyncrasies of JavaScript. What was this? Is this it? I mean, yeah, you could do your stupid code golf stuff. Foo is object, bar is object, map is object. Foo is foo, bar is bar, return fap, return map of foo. Map of foo is bar. Yeah, whatever. I mean, you could write some really confusing JavaScript. You could do that with any language. I'm just trying to remember. Somebody made a really convincing video of stupid things that don't work in JavaScript. Not that anybody should ever write bad code, but there's some really non-idiomatic things that you need to be aware of. Like, unlike Java, in JavaScript, null is actually an object, as opposed to, like, Ruby, where you've got nil, where nil is not treated as an object. You would normally think that null would mean I've got nothing in the absence of a value, but no, a type of a null is actually an object type. So you have to be careful. You have to check if something's an instance of an object, in order to, or there's other ways to do a null check, but whatever. Not a number is actually a number, so be careful about that too. So you can't use double equals, you have to use triple equals. Wait, no, I'm sorry, you can't use triple equals to compare not a number. You have to use is NaN to check if something's not a number. If you have an empty array, that evaluates to false. Just be careful about how you do your. I mean, use sane code. Don't do shit like this. But be aware that some code that you find out there will have to improve to do stuff like this. So there's just tons of. There's some bad code out there. Don't be expecting that you can read other people's code necessarily. I mean, if JavaScript had strong typing, that could alleviate some of these concerns. And like you're saying earlier, EMCA script 6 does offer classes, and with classes must come strong typing. So there's the capability to write good code, but that doesn't mean that other people who write JavaScript are going to write good code. So it's possible that if you go searching for examples, you might find some things that are counterintuitive. You might find things in library code that does some that counters your expectations, in which case you just shouldn't use that library. Use a better library. Yeah. I mean, there's all kinds of dumb things in JavaScript that are silly. And this is entirely the negative perspective of it. Like you said, there's a lot of good JavaScript code out there. Functions can execute themselves, which is pretty exciting. I mean, they should be able to, but things are complicated. Just be careful about what libraries you choose to use. There is idiomatic JavaScript out there. To have an immediate example of bad JavaScript. Now, I just know that, like, when I try to use tools to troubleshoot other people's code, it's a mess. But in terms of having bad code, no, I myself don't write bad code, and the examples I try to follow usually aren't that bad. It's just when people ask you, are you a JavaScript developer? Great, can you help me with this JavaScript code? Or something of that nature. It's just a waste of time, and it's difficult to explain that to management or people of that sort. Or even people who are just asking for help, trying to act friendly and say, I want to help, I want to better appreciate the concepts behind something. And then they go continue trying to beat their hand with a hammer or something. It's just not the most... Yes, you can do good things with JavaScript, but you want to make sure you're doing it with the right people. Yeah. That's true. I don't think I've been unfair to JavaScript. I think I've been very measured in my criticism of it. Yeah. I'd much rather learn the things that are more, I don't know, that offer me something out of it as well. And I mean, to your point, you're acting like I've not done anything with JavaScript, and that's not true. I have worked with Node.js, and I've collaborated with another developer, and we have jointly released this application, RelayJS. I don't need the Discord page open, but yeah, even writing this, like, made my head spin. There's just so much code involved. It's all imperative. You have to make sure that you allocate your resources properly and deallocate them when you're done. I'd just rather not have to be bothered with all the nuances of that. I want to use a language that offers me some advantages as a person with a computer science degree. As a person who studied compilers, who studied operating systems, who studied real-time and distributed systems, who understands a lot of pretty advanced concepts, I don't want to be bothered to do my memory allocation and memory deallocation every time I need to do that sort of thing. I want a language that can handle that for me. And as long as I'm stuck on all these tiny little details, there's no way I'm going to be able to focus on larger projects. Yeah, it's great what you can do with JavaScript. You just have to be really good at making sure that you keep track of all the details and don't lose anything anywhere. You can do a lot of really great things with it, though, and it's all because it's a scripting language and because browsers support it, well, mostly the latter, you can just run it on any operating system, any browser that supports it. And it's not even that hard to write something simple and make something simple that works, but more advanced things are a little bit more challenging. What was my latest challenge here with the relay chess stuff? I know I was just using that as an example of things I've helped develop, but where did I get stuck with this? Like, this took me multiple attempts to finally get this right, to make sure I'm allocating the thing and getting the audio service running and looping or not looping. Now, we are using a third-party library for the music, so we don't have to write our own music library, and that's cool. But, and after I'd written all that code to play one song while you're logging in and a different song while you're in the lobby, this other developer added a menu controller, basically allows you to log in from the common page that now contains the login page. I think Python's pretty inviting. Python has issues for sure. I'm trying to come up with an analogy for that. Part of the problem is that Python had to upgrade from 2 to 3 just because the original goals of the language and the goals of Python 3 were so disparate. And unfortunately, they lost some developers along the way doing that upgrade. I think they handled it as well as they could have, but it's just the original language and Python 3, they have different goals. I think it's fairly intuitive. I mean, writing everything from scratch isn't very fun either. This developer had come by numerous times in my chat here for my stream, and he explained things to me very well. This is a trial by fire for sure, because I haven't done any web development until this point. And so to go from that to doing something in Angular with Node.js it's a bit of a learning curve, but nothing I can't handle. But just to achieve anything, just takes time. And I'd rather do something in a language, in a high-level language, than in a low-level language. And you're not going to convince me that JavaScript is a high-level language. It really isn't. With ECMA script or EMCA script 6, sure, there's some aspirations. But by and large, most of the libraries, most of the code you find, it's just not designed around the level, around the concept of a higher order language. Okay, indentation-based scripts are not pretty, I guess. Yeah, I could see that. This is HTML code that's... I think this is a partial here. Let's see, what is this? No, I'm sorry, this is the HTML. I could see that this sort of syntax where you have this and then you indent and then you have a scope and you indent further. There's all kinds of ways you can write code. There's really no one standard, I guess. Some people use spaces, some people use tabs. I'm sure there's other issues and concerns. I don't see. I'm not sure if your concern is with the level of indentation or just like having brackets to instantly see blocks. I mean, we've got the brackets too, but like some people do try to one-line things occasionally. Sometimes they write it in this one true base style. There's all kinds of ways you could format the code, and that's really not a fault of this language. But also because we're using a database, now I'm having to deal with data structures that are defined through JavaScript. And without strong typing, that's just kind of a mess. I'd rather be able to strongly type my language and define my data format in a way that doesn't rely on me writing code, but can be defined through configuration or through whatever you want to call something that's not code, such that it's possible to write a unit test and see if the data is persisting in a manner that makes sense, but whatever. Oh, you were talking about Python. Yeah, okay. That makes a lot more sense now. Yeah. Yeah. Python does depend on indentation. We gotta show this now. Python's how we're flying. I just learned it last night. Everything is so simple. Just print, hello world. This other developer's like, I don't know, dynamic typing, white space. I just type import anti-gravity and everything just works. It's perfect. I don't have to understand what I'm doing at all. It's basically just this fellow saying. It occurred to me, this might be a reference to Mary Poppins and some dude who's floating in a room, especially with the concept of a medicine cabinet, but okay. Yeah. Python's different. I mean, I'm not going to judge it for the whole indentation thing. I'd far sooner judge it for the fact that the original language and that Python 3 are different. That, I would point out, has been the cause of numerous problems, just because it took them forever to get from 2 to 3, and that 2 and 3 don't offer the cleanest migration path. And so, I don't know, 3 just never was fully realized. I don't know. I thought I had a point. I've since forgotten it. I've been rambling for how long now? I've been rambling for an hour 11 minutes. And I still haven't gotten back to my original point, which was that I'm trying to do this in an object-oriented language. I'm really trying. Okay. Yeah, Elixir's cool. I do want to learn Elixir and Phoenix. Let's bookmark this. Electron, it is quite useful. It's the right way to do what I'm doing. It's the right way to do it. In terms of convincing Zug, it's just not going to happen. let's see. Oh, right, so let's copy this, go over here, just retain that. I think that's everything from this session, so we can close that out. But yeah, we got the Ruby Chess library, which consists of only a few files. It's pretty simple and straightforward. It's all open source, open licensed. Yeah. Well, and the funny thing is, so Java is his comfort zone. Let me just open up Ruby Chess here. And I don't know. Let's start with chess.rb. Okay. So I guess the idea, the way some of these things are declared is just a touch different. We're defining attribute reader, the couple parameters. I haven't touched Ruby in forever. So this is actually something I'm not so familiar with. But here we have a constant for white, a constant for black. We initialize a board, putting a rook on 0-0, a bishop on 2-0, king on 4-0, etc., etc. 0 up to 7 for each column, 2 up to 5 for each value of row. Put a pawn there. So we got pawns. We got white pawns, we got black pawns. For each column, and I'm confused how this is working. Column, column, comma one equals pawn new black. Somehow this puts pawns on rows on the second rank and seventh rank. Oh wait, they even did this in the whole XY stupidness where you have your columns listed, then your rows listed. They even followed that to the letter, the same way that Zug did it. Any idiomatic chess program does things rank and then file, or I'm sorry, row and then column. But this one follows Zug's paradigm of doing things column and then row in the coordinates. No, this isn't using bitboards. No. Not at all. And so, okay, I mean, there's some syntactic things to learn. Like, this is getting the board attribute out of this instance and swapping or moving the piece from the from square to the to square, returning true upon success, which happens all the time. And we got a simple method. Is the king safe after the move from to two? And we check if the king's in check or not, and check if some from or two is not on the board, and we got all these helpful little helper methods. I mean, this is ignoring the particular syntax here. This is basically the same thing that Zug wrote in his own custom library, except this one was actually published on GitHub and is still being maintained, and other developers are using it. And I think there's an issue tracker. I don't want to go here. I want to go to Ruby Chess. This one. There are other Ruby chesses. No description provided is this is a command line game of chess. This was added to. Oh, that's kind of cool. Wait, this is a different Ruby chess. Gosh, damn it. I started this stream, I had a point, and now I'm scattered all over the place. Okay. Wow. So I found this using Google, and this is actually accessible through the Ruby gem library, so anybody who wants to install it can just type gem install ruby hyphen chess, and they automatically get all of this. They get the GUI, they get the console version, they're able to run a whole bunch of tests. There are some tasks to be done to make the code cleaner. But I was going to say that people, lots of developers have favorited this on GitHub, but that's not the case. So one second while I go help remedy this issue. Let's turn off the display capture. Let's turn off the... Well, okay, I can actually log in a separate thing. Like this, we hit sign in, we provide... You know, if I could even type my own username, that would be a positive step now, wouldn't it? But yeah, I can refresh this, and I could say we're going to watch this, see if people develop it. There's just the one branch. There's no known issues. But, yeah, people can still use the Ruby ecosystem to easily, conveniently install this on any system that already has Ruby and has Ruby gems installed. In terms of some of these things, yeah, it's... Obviously, this library could use improvement. I'm just saying, like, this looks almost identical to the code that Zug had written the other day. Somebody already wrote this, published it, and not only that, but got some pieces working here, so you could, like, click things and make moves. Does it do legal move validation? Yes, it does. So Zug didn't have to bother writing any of the Java code, but he would have had to become a little bit more familiar with Ruby. So let's see. Do I remember this line? Knight e4, castle, knight c3, bishop a3, bishop a1, check. Knight e7. I thought there was some clever mate here. But yeah, white's just up material. There's other fun lines. Oh, I'm sorry. Let me turn my display capture back on. I wish there were a shortcut key to do that. Is there a back button? Nope. But, yeah, let me just go through that again. Arg. Oh, there it is. Hey, I crashed the thing somehow. That's cool. But yeah, you can say new game, and you can go, and you can go. And, yeah, it validates the legal moves. I showed that earlier when it wasn't showing on stream, but a bit too lazy to show it a second time. Or rather, a first. So yeah, this is kind of a fun opening. And then black can take that, and you check black, and you take the knight, and that's GG. It's still kind of a mess, but white's better there. There's other ways to play it. White can win that other ways. But yeah, we have this library already out there. Zug just would have had to become a little bit more familiar with how Ruby works. And get out of the comfort zone a touch. But I'm not saying that that's necessarily the only Ruby library out there. If I remember right, Ruby Pocket, Sphinx, that's something I was trying to install forever ago. Yeah, let me try this again. Let's see, gem install Pocket Sphinx. That way I can get a program that's able to speak, right? Now the point of getting this, dependencies do I need? Sphinx base. Yeah. Oh. This is pretty cool, though. Somebody wrote a bot to help them play Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes. So, you might be able to figure out quickly which one's the bot and which one's the player. Sorry for the cinematic.
Okay. Digit 6?
6.
Vowel, no?
No vowel.
Car, yes?
Car.
Batteries, 2?
2 parts of it.
Freak, no?
No freak.
Parallel port, no?
No parallel port. Done.
Defuse memory.
Round 1.
Sequence 31324.
Press 2.
So,
defuse memory.
Round 2.
Just to give you an idea.
Sequence 32143.
Press 2.
Defuse memory.
Round 3.
I mean, that's the basic idea, is that somebody taking the software game and running an AI that's able to listen to them speak and then speak back to them. Yeah. And they published the code for this. And forever ago, I had tried to install it and just couldn't get Ruby installed properly. But now that I think I've got the ability to install gems, because I tried again, and I want to find this on GitHub, where they published the code. Is this it? voice-controlled helper bot Python. Oh, this is Python-based. That's not the one I'm looking for. I thought they did this with Ruby. A Slack bot in Ruby. That's not what I'm looking for. Saw Python as well. Maybe it was Python. I don't think so, though. I thought... Oh. Okay, fine. Where was this? Is this it? Okay, where'd it go? Where's the source code? There we go. Friend is learning Ruby, so he made a bomb defusal assistant. Yeah, that was so good. Oh, wait. Where's my other comments? Yeah, here we are. This hasn't been touched in about, well, a year. 10 months. So, can I get this? Whoa. My cursor's freaking out. I should disable my scroll wheel. I'm dealing with a different mouse here that the mouse does respond to my clicks properly. I never really got around to making the announcement, but I'm still playing my match against Lee Chess Master Atrophy tomorrow. So today I've got my mouse, the one that I can click, and it doesn't like double or triple or quadruple click. It just clicks once, as it should. Alright, Pocket Sphinx Ruby is what I need there. Ruby, RBEV, and Bundler. For OS X, install Homebrew. For Windows, run Charlie after having done a bundle. Install Pocket Sphinx, Sphinx Base, and eSpeak. Yeah, I'll bother with all this off stream at some point. But yeah, once you're able to get the environment, like the Ruby environment, the gem installer, like ruby gems, the bundler. Once you get those, extremely difficult to install library or application managers and library managers and get all that installed. At that point, you can follow some simple steps to get your particular library of choice or application of choice installed. And the beautiful thing about the way it's installed is that you can, it's installed with the source code. You can copy the source code, modify it, and install your modified code, but whatever. The new Azure AI. Go figure. Now, by Azure AI, are you talking about the OpenAI thing, or is this something different? Whatever. Oh, okay. So this must be competing with TensorFlow. And this must somehow try to make things more convenient or something. Even though TFLearn is a pretty compelling library on its own, but yeah, it's cool to see that Microsoft is starting to get their head into the game there. Fully managed cloud service that allows you to easily build, deploy, and share predictive analytics solutions. That's cool. And OpenAI is now based in Azure, allows them to conduct research, etc., etc. Yeah. So that's cool. But I'm not installing Homebrew on my Windows machine unless I need it for this. I'll bother with this again off stream because this took a lot of effort the first time to try to figure it out. I forget why it even failed, but I think now that I've got Pocket Sphinx here, I forget how to test whether Pocket Sphinx is installed or runs. But it's not going to work without the dependent data anyway. What I did get working last time was the ability for Windows to speak text back to me. Pocket Sphinx, I believe, is a text or a speech interpreter. A Ruby wrapper for CMU Sphinx. For the other direction, use eSpeak. If I remember right, it was eSpeak. Is it still installed? No. Gosh darn it, I forget how it worked. Somehow I did manage to install a program that could speak. I might even have it on my desktop. Oh, man. It's one thing that leads to another, to another, to another. Got so many things going on. Voice Master. I guess I could try that. This is a download of that library. I could always change directory here. Ruby Charlie. Yeah, this requires other stuff. Load bundler setup, gem install bundle. Bundles now, or bundler is now installed, and the documentation for bundler will be installed momentarily. I don't expect I'll be able to get this going. That's not done, so do bundle install first. Man, I have to read directions. Okay. What are we talking about here? Bundler cannot continue. Yeah, so this is the point where you're supposed to, like, RTFM before typing the commands. The command wasn't bundle install, it's just bundle. But that didn't work. First try this, see if there's any issues. Sure. Oh, that's what it wants me to try, but I'm not reading the directions, so why should I expect to have any success with that? If there aren't any issues, go ahead and file an issue, but no, I think the issue here is that I didn't have the data. Okay, error report template. Backtrace is in opening something. Oh. That's not even the way it recommended approaching this. Like, I thought I installed Pocket Sphinx and Sphinx Space and all that stuff. Perhaps not. Gem installs. Oh, I did this on Linux. That's where I put the Sphinx code. Could not find a valid gem Sphinx Space in any repository. But I did install Pocket Sphinx. Yeah. So this is going way off track, but it's nice how you can just plug and play your libraries into each other using. Well, okay, using a stable application deployer or library deployer, but admittedly this is kind of a mess to actually work with. Gem search, Sphinx space. That'd probably help if I were awake too. But, anyhow, it's not at all where I was going at the beginning of the stream. We have deviated off of a tangent, off of a tangent, off of a tangent, all to try to justify the fact that what I was originally attempting to do, not this, not that, originally attempting to do, was write a library where I could observe a Lee chess game using a trivial Ruby client, and then from there maybe add in features like spoken moves or noises, or being able to speak your moves into the program, or highlighting squares, or searching for similar games, doing a lot of really high-level things using other people's low-level libraries, or working on my other side project here, which I announced on the Leechess forum to much negative feedback, unfortunately. People were saying, oh, where did I even put it? Where is it? It's here somewhere. Whatever. Let's go through my history. Forum posts. Where'd I put it? Oh, this one. FEN Fuzzy Match. So, here, find a game that has a position that looks like this position. One of the other Leechess devs had taken an interest in coding something like this. Asked for my 2 cents on what's the right way to do it. I offered some feedback about how to search for material imbalances, as well as how to search for just pawn structures that are quite similar. He wrote up some code. I prototyped a really basic engine that could generate a key value. Where did I put that? Pawn encoder. Here it is. Sorry for the blinding light. Let's zoom that in. I don't claim to be a Ruby expert, but this would have taken a grand eternity to write in Java. Instead, I was able to write it in like 20-some lines of Ruby code. Some of those, including comments. And was able to copy a good deal from what I found in Stack Overflow. Again, there's almost certainly a more idiomatic way to do any of this, but this takes FEN string, expands it to a full, uncompressed FEN where all the numbers are converted into spaces, and then we splice this, grabbing the, basically this generates a 64-character bit mask. One could theoretically encode that as a 64-bit number. I don't really care about the encoding or compression. I'll leave that to people who care about systems. Here, my objective was just to get something functional, and in that I succeeded. So you asked, like, what's the point of any of this code? Like, what am I doing? So we got pawns A and pawns B for white pawns. This rotates, I think, up a rank. This rotates down a rank. And so we're able to check, do ranks 2 or 3 have a white pawn? Do ranks 3 or 4 have a white pawn? We're able to do that for every column, for both colors of pawns. And so we're able to identify pawns, ranks 2 through 5 of each color, using that to identify what opening we're in. Pawns that are advanced beyond the 5th rank, unfortunately, are ignored by this scheme, I think. We're checking our... There's a pawn on ranks 2 or 3, 3 or 4, 4 or 5, or 5 or 6. See, if a pawn makes it beyond the 6th rank, this doesn't really work very well for identifying the classification of position, but anyhow, yeah, I was able to write this while quite exhausted. Took me somewhere between a half hour, half hour to write this. It's not the most idiomatic thing ever. Originally, I'd written something a little bit simpler, and then copying some code and complicating it just a little bit so to export a 64-character string. You can use this to generate a index for any chess position that's noted in FEN format. And then you can do something like a Levenstein distance. Just use anybody's... Oh, come on. Do you not show... Okay. That's awful. But it shows like how many letters are in common between kitten and sitting versus Saturday and Sunday. It's really a terrible graphical visualization of Levenstein distance, so... Can we get an image, please? Not really. Well, fine. This tells you like how similar two words are. In terms of just the... Well, you can see that the word elephant and the word relevant have quite a bit in common. You don't really need to know much more beyond that to appreciate that a Levenstein distance could be appropriate for this kind of matching. Like, we have an E, an L, and an E. We have a non-identical letter. E does not match P. H does not match V. But A and T matches A and T, so the distance from elephant to relevant is 3. And so this kind of matching could apply to chess positions as well that have pawn structures and material imbalances and stuff. So that's why I wrote this encoder, so people could classify positions by opening scheme, not just by the moves, not just by the FEN itself, but be able to identify an entire class of openings and match positions on similarity using this metric. Oh no, I've studied algorithms. I know quite a bit. I studied Introduction to Algorithms. I participated in several, not nationwide, but very far-reaching multi-university competitions involving algorithmic contests. I'm drawing a blank on the name. That's really unfortunate. What was the name of the contest? Oh, it was the AMC Regional Programming Contest, where they would give you some really abstract problems, and they would give you like an hour or two. You and some team members would have one computer, and they would allow one of you at the computer at a time, and the rest of them, you had to go to the other room and try to figure out good ways to pseudocode your code, so when came your turn to start typing things at the keyboard, you could quickly solve the problem. So while my particular college never won the contest, because Canada always wins that, they like their hockey, they like their programming contests. We have other sports, but they're quite good at their stuff. We managed to place quite well several times. Especially for a team that just gets together on a whim. Yeah. I mean, you gotta give them credit where credit's due. Go Waterloo. They are quite proficient at what they do. They sure kicked our butts. But whatever. It's still fun, though. I mean, as students, what do we care? We just go for the adventure. It was fun. But, yeah, I'm aware of a number of concepts related to algorithms. So I already knew what a Levenstein distance was. But if I didn't, it still stands to reason that something like that can be used to compare whether two words are similar, or whether two 64-character strings are similar. So And there are other distance comparators as well. But it just happened to be one that came to mind. It's pretty simple to implement. It's O of M plus N, where M is the number of characters in the one string and N being the number of characters in the other string. Just walk through the strings and compare them one character at a time. So, it's pretty simple. But yeah, there are other ways to compare things too, but this would produce a 64-character encoding of just the pawn structure for a position. Math and physics student, so... for you, you just... Yeah, you have the notion of metric, and you see... Like, is there an appropriate metric out there for what I'm doing? And, I mean, that's more than sufficient. I'm just saying, like, I happen to know a lot of things, too. Although, that doesn't forbid me from using Google or DuckDuckGo or whatever when I need to use them. I'm actually curious now, can I use, you see that. New version of Java is ready to be installed. Thanks. Sure, why not? Let's do it. We'll do it live. Oh, fine. It went away. It wimped out. Decided it didn't want to upgrade anymore. But no, I was curious now. Chrome DuckDuckGo default. I want to know, is this doable? This doesn't seem like something that's doable. Oh, okay. Manage by search engine. Sure, why not? Nope, that's not it. Manage extensions, settings. Search, manage search engines. Hey, we could use Bing. Isn't Bing great? Other search engines. Are you serious? Is there that much animosity between Google and DuckDuckGo that they can't even list it here? Fine. And then we paste that thing that I found elsewhere. And then say, yeah, DuckDuckGo is going to be our new default. Just because it can. Ain't never going to use Yahoo. Ain't never going to use Bing. You know, ever since they got rid of Jeeves, I haven't been such a fan of Ask. AOL, yeah. Let's make AOL a default. I jest. But okay. Hey, look. Oh, wow. I was not expecting any of that. Alright, so... yeah, it doesn't log or spy on you. Also, it's got a cool mascot. That really can't be said of Google. But yeah, the whole spying thing is kind of important too. I didn't know that ASDF was actually a thing. Urban Dictionary. ASDF just is. Do not question the almighty power of ASDF. Okay. That's cool. Click save, and yeah, nice. So, that's cool. So yeah, I was ranting here about how I made the search engine thing. People provide feedback. They mean well. But... yeah, why not develop something less functional and then go from there to see if you can improve upon it? Well, because I actually have a concept that I'm trying to employ first. I might be too busy to actually code this stuff, but and part of the reason I'm kind of busy on that is that I see that another developer's also working on something very much like it. That doesn't prevent me from going forward, it just means that I'm competing with that other developer and for no reason, other than trying to get things correct, and not trusting that developer or just wanting to verify their results somehow. Okay, so why not implement the exact match? And next feedback was, why don't we just include everybody's games in the whole Explorer and the results? And my point is that I'm trying to develop a lightweight search engine that's performant, that encodes key characteristics of a position and allows you to identify similar positions by those key characteristics. This isn't by any means as over-engineered as what Sean's Chess Interface Database, SCIDB, does. It's 1,000 times more lightweight. I did install SCIDB the other, well, I guess week now. I haven't gotten back to it yet. Don't have time for anything, really. But yeah, they want to see the sort of thing built into the opening Explorer. I say, maybe, sure, whatever. Somebody comment on that. So, yeah, I got lost in some semantics here. He's trying to draw a connection between the opening search tool. It didn't occur to me that you could use the opening Explorer to search your own games, but okay, sure, why not? And I just don't know how that works. So, that's a cool idea, but, yeah, I don't get it. The other feedback I gotten on my FEN fuzzy match encoder is like, I'd like to see things characterized by opening or classified by opening. And yeah, that's the way the chess base does it. It's not the way Lee Chess does it, but it makes sense. But we haven't been able to, it hasn't been a priority to do it that way. We'll put it that way. But see, like, when we play these sorts of things, we get a c20 king's pawn game. Whereas if you play this, it's a queen's pawn game, right? Okay, so you play e4, d5, you have a Scandinavian. Play this, you get a black mardemer. And if you play the other move order, you get your queen's pawn game, and then you get your black mardemer. I found a bug with that forever ago. Where it would change the classification of the position based on the move ordering, which is... Oh, here we go. I bet this is still there. Queen's pawn game. Okay, A4 is not part of the book, right? This is a black mardemer. Whereas if you do it this way, D4, E4, black mardemer gambit. It's pretty clear that that's a black mardemer. This is the same position, but they call it a queen's pawn game. So, there are some problems with classifying things by opening code. And that, you really need a way to classify, well, is this a queen's pawn opening? Or is this a Scandi? Or what is it? I mean, here we get that same position by a different move ordering, and now it's a Scandinavian defense. Admittedly, this is a pretty absurd example, but it just shows the uselessness in some cases of classifying things by opening, because you're going to get what some people will say is the wrong opening code. And how do you fix that? It's a hard problem. So, I mean, as long as people are doing good moves, it's not a problem, but the minute somebody deviates from the book, you get non-standard classifications.
And I don't really care to classify these things that way. I want my own encoding scheme. All right, let's get our Java update installed. Just because we can. Let's see. Could be hard to classify. Yeah, you never know. There could be a huge effect on the opening. For what it's worth, SCIDB also struggles with that. Or SCIDB, or however you say that. 3 billion devices run Java. Not sure. That's probably saying 3 billion devices can run Java, not are currently running Java. Just, okay, whatever. Who cares? Yeah. Right. So I'm not convinced that the way that ChessBase does it is perfect. Although it's a pretty practical way. But LeeChess likes to hold things to a different standard when they get them going. LeeChess prefers to get things right the first time. And that makes implementing things kind of tricky. But, yeah. I think I've run out of things to talk about. I've successfully slacked off for 2 hours. And all I've got to show for it is this. Oh well. Let's do this. Black win! Black win! Black jump. Well, that was eventful. Yeah, maybe sometime I'll actually be motivated to try to view LeeChess games using this client and get to speak moves into it and all that fun stuff. Who knows? I hadn't intended to spend the whole time doing programming because I did want to get back and play some games before I went, but now I'm tired. What can you do? It is kind of late. Not that late. Just kind of. So. I'm kind of impressed by this second screen. I didn't even know it was there. Well. The winner is you. Know your meme. Yeah. Just seeing that. Oh, can I see this like full screen? We need to have it in the. Yeah. Good enough. Could make the Suggs offline picture or something. I don't know. That'd be cool. Oh, it doesn't have random color walks. I think you're right. Yeah. We need to have the random color walks in there. How hard do you think that would be to achieve? Like, it could have the board colors changing like a disco. Yeah. How about that? I think that needs to happen. And then, I don't know, you could have maybe a fish tank or something off there and little fishes swimming around. And somewhere in there you have like stockfish kibitzing moves. I don't know. There's all kinds of crazy things you could do. But yeah. Yeah, I just find it amazing. Okay, yeah, you had to get all the prerequisite libraries installed. But writing the actual code once the libraries are installed is not that difficult. And so, like, when Zug says he spent so many hours getting his thing working. That's great, but that's not a convincing reason to reinvent the wheel. Unless your objective is to understand and learn and be able to teach other people. And that has its own merits, too.